Subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon to never miss an update. Join the only official Telegram channel of Rao's IA Study Circle to get relevant material and important updates.
Hello everyone and welcome to Daily News Simplified, your one-stop solution to detailed analysis on current affairs which are published in the Delhi edition of Hindu newspaper. Articles dated 23rd of October 2021 are listed on your screen, and the timestamping for these articles is already given in the description box. So let us begin with the first article itself. Every year, Rao's IAS discusses questions from the prelims, which can be answered from the content that we publish. This shows the kind of content that we create is in sync with the requirement of the UPSC examination. So the question for today's discussion is from the modern history, and this question appeared as question number 47 in set A of UPSC prelim examination. The question says that in context of the colonial India, Shahnawaz Khan, Prem Kumar Sehgal and Gurbakhsh Singh Dhillon are remembered as. Well, according to the modern history, the answer to this question was officers of the Indian National Army. Similarly, Rao's IAS have taken up the question on the same context in its prelim test series Modern History Paper 3rd, where we have asked question on Indian National Army trial. And the first statement of this question was actually meeting the demand of what UPSC has already asked. If we go through the explanation that Rao's IAS has provided, in the explanation we have clearly mentioned the names of Prem Kumar Sehgal, Shahnawaz Khan and Gurbakhsh Singh Dhillon. This has actually proved the kind of focused approach adopted by Rao's IAS in its prelim test series. So the first article for today's discussion was published on page 8th of Delhi edition Hindu newspaper. This article explicitly talks about the recent visit made by the United Kingdom's Foreign Secretary and says that India-UK relations are going to be vital for the next coming decades. Now, let us understand this, that why this article is important for UPSC examination. From prelims perspective, UPSC has asked questions on the important keywords which were in the news. For instance, they have already asked questions on BTIA, they have asked questions on THAAD missile systems and many other important keywords. In the mains examination, India-UK relation is important under the heading of bilateral relations in GS paper 2, as well as the effects of policies and politics of developed and developing countries, because UK is a developed nation and India is a developing country. So given this relevance, it becomes important for us to understand that what is the background of India-UK relationship, why India and UK need each other, what are the important aspects of this relationship, what is the basic issue behind the BTIA, and we will also look into some of the other contentious bilateral or multilateral issues between both these nations. And finally, we will give you some of the way forward possible to write a good answer. So let us start with going into why we are actually reading about India-UK. Well, when it comes to the mains examination, UPSC has taken one nation or the other from the perspective of bilateral relationship. In 2017, they took China. In 2019, they took Japan. In 2015, it was Africa as a continent. And in 2013, it was Sri Lanka. So, given this basic trend, we can easily deduce that asking questions on the United Kingdom is not a surprise from the UPSC side. So, given that trend in mind, we will read the India-UK relationship in much more detail. So, let us start with what is the basic background behind India-UK relationship. Well, we all know since our school days that India was a colonial state. We had been the colony of Britain for about 190 years if we start the history of colonial period from the Battle of Plassey. Even before that, India had some relations with the United Kingdom dating back to 500 years long. Post-independence, India and UK started on a different note altogether. They started on a cordial relationship despite having bitter colonial background. Relations were weak between the Cold War because there was a bipolarization which was going on at the global stage. However, disintegration of the USSR, weakening of the communism and the rise of globalization during 1970s, 80s and 1990s brought India into the different picture of UK's geopolitics. And this actually led to the expansion of economic trade between both the nations. The defense relation has found a new platform in the recent years. We have seen that India became a partner to many of the European nations, including France, from where we have recently purchased the Rafale aircraft. Given that criteria, India has been boosting the defense relationship with the UK, and on the sidelines of the Commonwealth grouping, both the countries have very cordial bilateral relationships. But there is one bone of contention that United Kingdom has been pro-USA, and on the other hand, India had provided over-reliance on Russia, both on the cultural as well as the strategic partnership. And this has created small hiccups in the relationship between both these nations. So given this background, let us look into what is the need for India to go for the good relationship with the UK and vice versa. Well, India is the third largest economy in terms of purchasing power parity. It means that India has a huge democracy, demand and development agenda. Given this basic foundation, India also have a higher political, military and cultural power, which is going to be expanded in the future anyhow. Post-Brexit, that means post-British exit from the European Union, we are looking to build a better bilateral partnership than what we had previously. India is also looking for helping UK and also getting help from the United Kingdom on the different parameters, including the current COVID crisis. Both the countries have been building strong strategies. They have been importing and exporting medical equipments as well as providing basic help to the supply chains. British Council has provided a report in which they have clearly supported that India is nothing but a great opportunity for the United Kingdom, and United Kingdom should have better engagement with India. Apart from this, India's diaspora is also making the headlines. They are providing the better contribution to both the economies, one to the United Kingdom in the form of employment opportunities and to India in the form of remittances. India is also looking for new defense partners. We are looking for a better strategic development, not only in the Indo-Pacific, but as a global power altogether. And this, we require better equipment, technology and capabilities. For this, India would definitely need United Kingdom. Both the countries have common grounds and common ideology when it comes to the international issues. Issues including climate change, terrorism, and of course the recent one, that is the refugee crisis. Both the countries have bilateral trade which stood around 15 billion in 2019 and 20. India has over 1.5 million diaspora living in Britain. UK is also the fourth largest inward investor. That means it is one of the best source for your FDI and FPI in India. And lastly, India is the third largest investor in UK and has also emerged as the second largest international job creator. If you do not know what is it, it simply means that Indian multinational companies are providing employment to the people of Britain. Now the point is, what kind of better relationships do we have between both these nations? Well, when it comes to the investment, as we have already seen, UK is the fourth largest investor and India is, on the other hand, third largest investor in UK. India and UK also share relationships on the ground of education. It included the United Kingdom India Education and Research Initiative, which was launched in 2005. Apart from this, there is also a joint working group on education, Newton Baba Fund, as well as the scholarship. There are hundreds and thousands of Indian students who are reading and studying in the United Kingdom universities, including your Oxford University, London School of Economics, and many others. India is also sharing good cultural link based on the historical aspect with the United Kingdom. Both the countries have signed Memorandum of Understanding on cultural cooperation way back in 2010. There is a Nehru Center which was established in London in 1992. It also provided a cultural outreach to the people who are living over there. Well, these kind of examples are not important for your prelim examination, but if you write these kind of examples in the mains examination, that will definitely add value to your answer and will help you to score more. And lastly, in the recent years, what we have seen that India has been conducting bilateral and multilateral defense exercises along with the United Kingdom. This includes your Konkan Shakti, Passage Exercise, Ajay Warrior, Himalayan Warrior, and many others. So given this diversity of relationship, we can easily conclude that India's relationship with the United Kingdom is on the cordial part. However, the high-end exchanges of people, money and trade is yet to be realized. UPSC has already asked a question on broad-based trade and investment agreement. And in this, they have asked that from which organization or which grouping this agreement belongs. This question was asked in 2017 and I leave it on you to answer this question in the comment box. So when this question was asked, BTIA was in news for various reasons and there was a controversy also. So let us understand this, what this BTIA is all about. Well, India is trying to finalize its BTIA or broad-based trade and investment agreement. In this trade, we also have some of the elements of services which may or may not change to a particular nation. Well, India was signing the BTIA with the entire European Union. But as we have seen that there was a case of Brexit, hence Britain came out of the European Union. Now, India has to go for a separate deliberation or separate discussion on BTIA with United Kingdom. Now, the point is, the controversy which was lying between India and the European Union also lies with the trade agreement between India and the United Kingdom. The point is that the European Union, and the same is true with your United Kingdom also, they want a reduction on the automobile, wine and spirits and wanted India to open the financial sector such as banking, insurance, postal, legal, accountancy and many other for the companies which are coming from the European Union or to be specific, United Kingdom. On the other hand, in exchange, India sought free movement of service professionals. Well, this is the advantage which India is holding right now. We have those IT professionals in the country who are extremely educated and very professional, and they want to enter into the international market, especially the European and America. And India wants a better visa regime. India wants better labor codes and employee protection schemes for those people. The point is that there is a conflict between both these demands. Now, as United Kingdom has left the European Union, it would be better for Britain to revamp the BTIA agreement and provide better system to the immigrants coming from India. This is taken as an opportunity for both India as well as the United Kingdom. But even if United Kingdom is ready to provide any kind of trade related negotiations or trade related deliberation, India has remained partially or completely cautious related to the new trade agreement at the global level, because we are going through the phase of protectionism at a world stage. And rise of protectionism along with the trade war which we have seen recently between US and China, India is very apprehensive about any kind of trade agreement to be signed with the developed nation. So, what they have to do, both the countries should come together to find a trade agreement which can suit demands of both the countries in sectors related to pharmaceutical, financial technologies, chemical, defense production, petroleum and food product. In food product, the most important factor is sanitary and phytosanitary measures. For this, you should read more on the WTO trade agreements related to the food items. If both these nations want better bilateral relationship, well, they have to meet the following challenges. The first important challenge which both these countries need to find is to find a better place for United Kingdom in European nation. Well, United Kingdom has already left the European Union as a group. This has already impacted those companies which have heavily invested on the Indians and the Indian product in the United Kingdom. And what we have seen is that there is a lesser exports from the Indian side to the United Kingdom. Secondly, there is a stagnancy which we are observing between the relationship in the past 5 years. Illegal migration has also become a bone of contention between both the nations, as according to the United Kingdom, there are around 1 lakh illegal Indians who are living in the country. India is also apprehensive about the closeness of United Kingdom to the Pakistan and China. Why? Because both these are considered to be enemy nations to India. So any kind of closeness between these three nations will go against the wishes of India in Asia and global level as a whole. These kind of issues were seen when the parliamentary inquiry report from UK has said that they can impose more strict visa norms of India than compared to China. There is another complaint which is made by the investors from the UK. There was a case of Crane energy crisis which took many years to get resolved regarding the energy security in the country. The same investors are now apprehensive and want India to have timely and logical settlement of the industrial dispute. Well, for this matter, India has already started number of schemes including your insolvency and bankruptcy code. Then we have pro-US instance of the United Kingdom makes it prone to those nations which have been anti-US or those nations which have any kind of antagonism to the United States. If not, have any kind of close relationship with the enemies or virtual enemies of the United States, which includes Russia. So India's closeness to Russia or Central Asian countries, or in fact those countries where communism is at the peak level, UK will find it hard to make any kind of close relationships. And lastly, we have the policies of the Labour Party, that is one of the party fighting elections in the United Kingdom. What they have done? Well, they have criticized India's policy at global level, despite the fact that India has maintained that it will not tolerate any kind of external interference in its sovereign decisions. Well, they have protested against India's removal of Article 370 related to the Jammu and Kashmir and also amendment to the Citizenship Act. They have also led concern about the farmers' protest which took place last year and has been continued till now. So these kind of issues has kept the strain between the relationship which were far more cordial in the last few decades. In order to resolve these kind of issues, what we need? Well, we need the following suggestion. First of all is the both country require a free trade agreement concluded ASAP. It should be timely, it should be logical settlement on the industrial dispute. Well, they should also provide the facilitation to the bilateral trade and provide detailed assessment in order to improve the bilateral trade between both the countries. UK should also live up to the commitment it has made on the extradition of the Indian fugitives. We know the case of Vijay Mallya and many others. UK on its side should also ensure that the kind of concentration it is making on China and Pakistan should not hurt its relationship or depth of its partnership with India. And lastly, both the countries can improve their bilateral relationship through security and defense cooperation, joint military exercises on regular basis, and reforming the multilateral institutions including your World Trade Organization, UN reforms, which includes United Nations Security Council and its permanent expansion. So given this entire discussion, now we will be in a position to answer this question. We have framed this question on the lines of what UPSC has already asked in the past years. The question says that the time has come for India and United Kingdom to build a strong contemporary relationship, one involving global and strategic partnership that will have a great significance for Asia and world as a whole. Well, when we go to the statements like this, the first and most important thing for us is to identify how to divide your entire answer in different parts. It could be easy for you to write an introduction and a conclusion, but what about the body? Is this question talking about pros and cons? Is it talking about positives or negatives or not? Well, the question has just said the time has come. So that your answer should be based on what time has come. What time this question is actually talking about? Write on that. The second thing is strong contemporary relationship. Write 2-3 points on this strong contemporary relation. and then write some of the points on how this relationship will help India in boosting its stand in Asia as well as world as a whole. You can also write the multilateral institutions and their reforms in this question. Given this question and its discussion, now I will leave you with this important prelim related question. So read this question carefully and answer in the comment box. Let us now move to the next article for the day. This article got published on page 1st of Delhi edition Hindu newspaper and talks about the stance which was kept recently by the central government in the Supreme Court. Well, as far as context goes, Union government told the Supreme Court that the West Bengal government does not have any absolute power. See, the word which they have used is absolute power to keep CBI from investigation inside the state. It simply means that central government has explicitly told the Supreme Court that states like West Bengal cannot restrict the functioning and the investigation process of a central bureau of investigation. Now, why the government was speaking like this in the Supreme Court? Well, they were just responding or they were just replying to a suit, a legal suit, which was filed by the West Bengal government under Article 131 of the Indian Constitution. And through this article, they have just challenged the jurisdiction of the CBI. They have said that CBI cannot interfere in number of cases involving the state government in an intrusive manner. Well, from the UPSC perspective, it is important for us to understand that why such kind of issues are arising. What is the Section 6 of the Delhi Special Police Establishment Act, which empowers Central Bureau of Investigation to conduct the independent inquiry? What is Article 131 of the Indian Constitution? And this discussion will help us to prepare on the Indian polity and Indian Constitution for your prelim examination. And for mains examination, it will also help us to understand some of the basic tenets of the non-constitutional bodies in India. So let us start with what is the Section 6 of the DSPE Act. Well, this section deals with providing as well as withdrawal of consent. Now, what is this consent? Well, this consent is nothing but a kind of permission which is given to the Central Bureau of Investigation by a particular state government to conduct the investigation or to take over the criminal case. Now, the issue of consent or the permission given by the central government has remained a bone of contention between both center and the state. Center has argued that these kind of consent is not at all required in order to conduct an honest and impartial investigation. On the other hand, state government has argued that these kind of consent makes them more powerful and more sovereign while deciding whether they should allow a central agency to investigate in the law and order situation of the state or not. Well, as we know, the law and order situation come under the control of the state government under the 7th schedule of the Indian Constitution state list. So, given that criteria, state government has always raised voice against the intervention made by the CBI in cases involving the state law and order. Well, as per the Section 6, Central Bureau of Investigation require a general consent and it is necessary to take such a consent. However, this consent should only be given by the state government and not by Delhi and the other union territories. It simply means that if CBI wants to conduct an investigation in the region of Delhi or any other union territory, including your Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh now, will not require any sort of consent or permission from the authorities. There are multiple cases where state government has either completely declined providing the consent or has kept decisions on the consent for so long as idle. We have seen the case of Andhra Pradesh and West Bengal where this consent was completely withdrawn and no permission was given to the CBI to conduct an investigation on the corruption cases where even the politicians were charged. Now, from the discussion, it is clear that CBI requires some or the other kind of consent from the state government before conducting the investigation. This also brings us to the important thing that what is Article 131 which was utilized by the state government. Well, this article of the Indian Constitution provide original jurisdiction. Original jurisdiction here means that it is available only to the Supreme Court of India. This article, this jurisdiction cannot be utilized, cannot be used by the high courts or the lower judiciary. This article provides that the original jurisdiction of the Supreme Court deals with the disputes involving the legal rights. See, the word is legal rights. Do not get confused in this point. It is not saying any constitutional right. It is not saying anything which is beyond the legal measures. Let's say state government say that central government has breached their rights on ethical basis or on the moral basis. It will not fall in the category of legal rights. So you should have basic understanding of these words as well. Well, it takes the jurisdiction on the cases which involves government of India and one or more states, government of India and any state or the states in one side and one or more states on the other side and between two or the more states. The current case of Central Bureau of Investigation lies in the first category where there is West Bengal in one side and the Union government on the other side. So these kind of cases provide states the ample space to reduce the kind of over-centralization or the interference of the central government in the administration of the state government. Plus, it also provides better avenues to the state in order to practice the cooperative federalism as well as live up to the principles of the federation in the country like India. Now, given this discussion, please, if you want to read more on the Central Bureau of Investigation, how it is formed, what is the composition, how it was created and how it functions, everything was discussed on the Daily News Simplified dated 25th May 2021, for which we have already provided link in the description box. So you can go through the link and watch this video to learn more on Central Bureau of Investigation. With this discussion in place, let us now move to the questions attached to this article. So read this question carefully and answer in the comment box. Let us now move to the next article for the day. This article got published on page 8 of Delhi edition Hindu newspaper and talks about the recent move taken by the Indian government, that is Ministry of Defense, to deploy the BrahMos missile in Arunachal Pradesh bordering China. And this move will give definitely a security boost to the region. Whenever we face these kind of current affairs in the newspaper, the relevance comes from the fact that important defense related current affairs is and could be asked by the UPSC in the prelim examination. So the content for today's discussion will be everything to know about the BrahMos missile which India is using right now. So BrahMos missile, well, the name is nothing but a combination of BrahMos, that is Brahmaputra, and Moskva River, which is in Russia. This is India's first supersonic cruise missile to enter into service. Entry into the service means that it is ready to use. Now, for those who do not know what a cruise missile is, well, you should first understand what is a ballistic missile. When we launch a particular missile, it takes a particular trajectory and then fall back to the earth. This is the ballistic missile. The halfway of the ballistic missile or the half pathway of the ballistic missile is functioning on the basis of fuel or what we call as the propellant. The next half part of a ballistic missile functions on the cause of gravity. On the other hand, cruise missile run parallelly to the surface of the earth. They does not have a parabolic pathway. They just run on the parallel to the surface of the earth. Hence, they are known as cruise missiles. Well, the BrahMos as of now was designed, developed and produced by the BrahMos Aerospace. It is nothing but a joint venture of DRDO and Mashino Stroinia of Russia. That means it is a collaboration between Russia and India. It is a two-stage missile, which means the first stage or the first fuel used in the missile will be solid propellant. The second fuel is liquid ramjet. This missile could be fired from land, warships, submarines and in fact the Sukhoi 30 fighter jet used by India, which means it could be fired from the air as well. As of now, the speed of this missile is Mach 2.8, that is 2.8 times the speed of sound. It is world's fastest anti-ship cruise missile also, which is like an honor to India. Government of India, as of now, is looking to increase the speed of this missile and its range. As of now, Government of India has increased its range to 400 kilometers from the existing 290. But they are planning to increase it further to 1500 kilometers at a speed of Mach 5 or 5 times the speed of sound. Now, given the discussion that we have done from the prelims perspective, now I leave you with this important question. So read this question carefully and answer in the comment box. With this, now we move to the last article for the day. This article got published on page 1st of Delhi edition Hindu newspaper and talks about India's target towards achieving the net zero at the international platform. Well, India is looking for, but not yet committed, about achieving the net zero target in the near future. Well, the context says that India has not entirely ruled out that it will not try to achieve net zero. However, it has not yet committed, but it is looking forward towards this important issue at a global level. Well, what we can deduce from this article is that in the near future, India can also go for providing the net zero targets on its own. But on the same platform, India has also made this clear that India as a developing nation also expect the developed nation to provide $100 billion of financial assistance every year to the developing countries. It simply means that India is looking for net zero target, but at the same time they want money coming from the developed nation because they have technology, money and expertise to help India to achieve its goal of net zero target. Now, from the prelims perspective, it is important to understand important key terms used in the environment and ecology. From mains perspective, this topic is important in your general studies paper 3 under the category of environment and ecology. So, in this discussion, we will look into what do we mean by the term net zero emission. We will also need to understand that when does the world need to achieve this net zero emission target. We will also look into some of the timeline given by the Paris deal and how this net zero emission could be achieved. So let us look into what is the meaning of net zero emission. Well, it simply means that the emission which we are making in terms of greenhouse gases should be balanced by removing the greenhouse gases through the process of carbon removal. Now, I understand this in a simpler terms. Let's say on today, that is on 23rd of October, world has produced, let's say, 1 gigaton of CO2. It is just a hypothetical case. So do not get into the quantity as such. And on the same day, that is on 23rd of October, we have removed, let's say, 0.8 gigaton of CO2 from the environment. It means that right now on this day, that is in 24 hours, we have added extra 0.2 gigaton of CO2 into the environment. Now what will happen? Now this extra quantity of CO2 will keep on compiling, will keep on consolidating over the years and will increase the greenhouse effect on the planet. It will impact the entire ecosystem. It will impact the entire environment as well as the species, including the humans themselves. So what we need to do is we have to go for net zero emission. That means if we are producing 1 gigaton of CO2 every day, we should remove not 0.8 but 1 gigaton of CO2 every single day. It means what we produce should be what we remove, and this should be done through carbon removal process. Well, there are hundreds of solutions which are provided in order to remove the carbon from the environment. The best one is the natural one. Grow trees, remove the carbon. But trees can only remove carbon from the environment. What about the other greenhouse gases? Who will look after for those greenhouse gases? So that requires human efforts to come into the picture. We should start by removing the human caused emission first. And in that case, we should take the help of natural process like forest. We should take the carbon sequestration process. We should take the cases of carbon sink in forest as well as the oceans. And apart from that, we should also expand the process and the technologies involved in the capture and storage of carbon from the environment. Through these processes, we'll be able to achieve the net zero emission. But the question is, till when? Well, the answer to this timeline is that if we want to control the global temperature by 1.5 degrees Celsius by the end of this century, what we need net zero CO2 before or around 2050 and net zero greenhouse gases before 2070. So, if we achieve these two important targets, we will be able to control the global temperature at 1.5 degrees Celsius. But if we want to go for less intensive target, that is to achieve around 2.0 degrees Celsius by the end of the century, then we can expand our emission, we can go for more combustion, we can go for more emission of CO2 till 2070. But this will increase the temperature to 0.5 degrees at a global level, which should not be adopted at all. Well, all this is given by the International Panel on Climate Change and its particular report on the global warming. So this is a very authentic data. You can utilize this in the mains answer writing as well. So the aim of the world community should be to go for the first option as soon as possible. And this is one of the reasons why developed nations are calling India time and again to come up with its own target to achieve net zero emission. When it comes to the solutions which is provided in order to control the greenhouse gas emission, well, the first one is phase out the coal plant and start on the renewable energy such as solar, wind and other. Go for retrofitting of the buildings. For instance, utilizing white colors on the rooftops in order to have better albedo. Decarbonize the cement, steel and the plastics from the consumption. Shift to the electric vehicle, that too on the solar power. Increase the public transportation in order to reduce the per capita emission of the carbon and greenhouse gases. Decarbonize the aviation and the shipping industry, that too utilizing the green energies. Halt the deforestation and increase the restoration of the degraded land. This includes the expansion of the forest area. The best example here I would like to give is the expansion of green belt, which India has envisaged on its highways, that is national highways, and also creating a green shadow belt in the state of Rajasthan. Apart from this, it also calls for the reduction of the waste of food. Why? Because less food is waste, less food is produced. And less food is produced means less emission from the agriculture, which include the highest possible emission on methane gases. And lastly, eat more plants and less meat. It means protect the biodiversity. Because when biodiversity is protected at a global level, it will provide the ecological stability. And ecological stability always acts as one of the best sources for carbon sink or carbon sequestration. So given that thing, we should go for all these 10 initiatives in order to promote the net zero emission in countries like India. So given this discussion in place, now I will leave you with the question of the day. Answer to yesterday's question was option C. So read the question of the day clearly and completely and answer in the comment box. With this discussion in place, now we come to the end for today's Daily News Simplified. Thank you.